Welcome to Season 5 of Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. I'm Joshua Sharfstein, Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement and a former health commissioner here in Baltimore, Maryland. Our goal with this podcast is to bring scientific evidence and experience to shed light on critical health issues. If you have questions or ideas for us, please send an email to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes.
Hi, I'm Lindsay Smith Rogers, producer of Public Health On Call, and today the topic is Disease X. Our experts are Anita Cicero and Amesh Adalja of the Johns Hopkins Center for Health Security. The host is Dr. Josh Sharfstein. You may be wondering, just what is Disease X? Let's listen.
Amesh Adalja, Anita Cicero, thank you so much for joining me on Public Health On Call to talk about Disease X. Dr. Adalja, I'll start with you. What is Disease X?
Disease X is a concept that arose from the fact that when we're thinking about pandemic preparedness, we're not always going to know what the pandemic pathogen is going to be. It could be something that we've never heard of. It could be something that's not on anybody's list. And we still have to prepare for it because it is going to be something that's going to be very disruptive and cause a lot of destruction. And even if we don't know what it is, there's actions you can take today to prepare for Disease X, even if we don't know specifically which virus it's going to be.
What are some of those actions?
The principal action is going to be developing medical countermeasures. And medical countermeasures include vaccines, diagnostic tests, treatments. And what we really need to do is do this proactively to think about what are the most likely candidates to cause a pandemic. And when you do that, you kind of center in on about 6 or 7 viral families. And what you could do is start working in those families by developing antivirals or monoclonal antibodies, diagnostic tests, vaccines, just getting ready, not knowing which of these family members is going to hit, but knowing that it's probably going to come from one of those families and doing it in a sustainable way that gets products into clinical trials ahead of time so that you can rapidly move when something materializes as a threat.
Anita, let me turn to you. How easy is it to talk about a disease that isn't here yet? I mean, making all these types of tests and treatments for things that we may never face.
It is a real challenge, but I think with SARS-CoV-2 and this pandemic with COVID-19, people now understand that maybe the scariest, most lethal, most transmissible viruses in the future could be a surprise, just like SARS-CoV-2 was a surprise globally. So when we talk about Disease X, it's really, how do you plan for the unknown virus? How do you plan for the viruses that are most likely to have characteristics that would result in a pandemic? And instead of picking, you know, now we're going to invest all of our money in future development of coronavirus medical countermeasures. Instead, we have to think about, as Amesh said, the other 6 or 7 viral families that might produce a member that causes the next pandemic. So we have to figure out a way to develop vaccines, therapeutics against those types of viruses. And they are limited. It's not an endless list.
All right, let's hear the list. I'm bracing myself, Dr. Adalja.
So it depends on how you divide it because there's been some taxonomy changes, but let's just start from the top. So the first viral family is orthomyxoviruses, and that includes influenza, and that's on everybody's pandemic list because flu has caused pandemic after pandemic. So that's definitely on there. Obviously, coronaviruses, because we've seen what COVID-19 has done. Pox viruses, I put on there just because of smallpox being a major scourge of humanity, something that has probably lessened as a pandemic threat because we've got really good vaccines, because we've got antivirals that have been developed out of the biodefense enterprise. But I still keep it on there kind of for other reasons. Then you have things like paramyxoviruses. Those include viruses like Nipah virus, which has spilled from bats into pigs and into humans. And that viral family has a lot of respiratory viruses that could have pandemic potential. There's a new viral family called pneumoviruses, which is kind of a subdivision of paramyxoviruses. I know this is kind of getting in the weeds, but that includes things like RSV and metapneumovirus. So that, I think, also has pandemic potential. We also have picoRNA viruses, which include enteroviruses and rhinoviruses. People might have heard about enteroviruses because of the one virus that is able to cause a polio-like syndrome caused by enterovirus D68. Those are also on the list. And then adenoviruses, which are respiratory viruses that can cause pneumonias, but also can cause coughs, colds, sore throats. So those, I think, are the most likely families that you're going to see a pandemic pathogen arise from. And what they all have in common is that they are all respiratory viruses. They are all viruses that cause known human disease right now, but many of them have animal counterparts as well that aren't really infecting humans, but could eventually develop the capability to infect humans. And that's where I think our pandemic preparedness should be centered.
So I want to ask you a question, Dr. Adalja, about the science behind this, because even for coronaviruses, if we had prepared based on SARS, we wouldn't have necessarily been prepared for SARS-CoV-2. How is it possible, even if you know the broad class of viruses that might be coming down the pike, to be ready for a very specific virus that we frankly haven't seen yet?
Well, I think when you start working in a viral family, you start to learn a lot about the common characteristics. So for example, if you think about SARS-CoV-2, the work that was done with SARS-CoV-1 and with Middle East Respiratory Syndrome, or MERS-CoV, really centered in on the spike protein being what we would call the correlate of protection, meaning that's what your vaccines need to induce antibodies against. That's what your monoclonal antibodies should target. So that's one example that we already knew we needed to make a vaccine that was spike protein, that was targeted at the spike protein. We needed to have monoclonal antibodies against the spike protein, and that came from earlier work. There also may be conserved parts of the virus that could be targets for antivirals. So for example, remdesivir is not a great example, but remdesivir is an antiviral that we use for COVID-19, but it wasn't designed for COVID-19. It was designed for other viruses. So you could imagine working on a viral family and developing some antiviral against one of the proteins that the virus makes, and that also having some broader spectrum than just that specific virus. You also develop diagnostic tests. You get more adept in that viral family.
Got it. So the idea isn't necessarily that you have everything that you need, but that you're a lot further along should a new virus pop up in one of these families.
Right. Just think about if we had the COVID-19 vaccines 2 weeks earlier, how many people's lives would have been saved? Having something available just days earlier will make a major difference in terms of morbidity, mortality, hospital capacity. So I think we want to be in a proactive position where we're poised to jump really quickly and use whatever knowledge we have of that viral family to push things forward.
Now, Anita, talk about the cost of trying to build this kind of capacity across all these different viral families.
Right. I think it's important to know that, and this is scary to hear, but right now the United States invests $0 in the advanced development of medical countermeasures for unknown viral threats for these viral families. There's a lot of money going into, and there'll be more going into, basic research, which is really important and can lead to discoveries. But in terms of really taking potential proofs of concepts, potential products through to advanced development, and even thinking through the manufacturing glitches and ironing those out to get things ready to pull off the shelf, there's zero money that's right now dedicated to that. And that's one of the things that we'd like to see change. I also want to say that it was a huge success through Operation Warp Speed to be able to produce a coronavirus vaccine so quickly. It was unprecedented, but people should not believe now that that's the new state of the art, that we can do that for any new virus that comes along. And that feat was only possible based on 15 prior years of actually coronavirus research after SARS-1, also the research that was invested in developing the mRNA platform, plus $12 billion in immediate funding from the federal government to get that those vaccines over the finish line. So in investments in developing medical countermeasures against a disease X are actually, you know, money well spent. And Senator Tammy Baldwin last summer put forward a proposed act called Disease X Medical Countermeasure Act. And in her proposal, she calls for $500 million over 4 years for part of HHS to do that advanced development work. So that's about the amount of money we're talking. But as Amesh said, every day we can find a vaccine earlier, that in itself saves $500 billion a day. So this kind of investment would be money well spent.
It does seem challenging, though, because partly you're asking for money for something that doesn't exist, and you're not even sure how much that is going to help. Might help some, might not help much. Maybe it helps a lot. but it's sort of like a double uncertainty.
Right. But I think what this pandemic has taught us, or should have taught us, is that we need to spread investment out because we're not sure what's coming. If we knew what was coming, that would be great. But since we don't, it's important to invest at least in the most dangerous, you know, potential viral families, so that when, you know, the next pandemic arises or the virus du jour arises, that we know we could pull this technology off the shelf that we have thought about manufacturing and adapt it to fit the new member of the family that is threatening the US and the world.
So, Dr. Adalja, I want to ask you a question here, which is that some people might listen to this conversation and think, great, we're now going to be putting labs, you know, all around the country working with really dangerous pathogens. And maybe that this work could actually create more risk than it alleviates. What would you say to that concern?
Remember that all of the viral families that I'm talking about, they infect us all the time. They're flu cases, they're adenovirus cases, they're paraflu, they're metapneumoviruses. So those are things that are already circulating and infecting people, causing disruption and causing death. So even if one of those doesn't strike us as a pandemic threat, the work you do in them are going to help with the endemic versions of those viruses. So we don't have a vaccine for RSV. We don't have a vaccine for metapneumovirus. We don't have vaccines for parainfluenza virus. We don't have antivirals for many of these things. So even if none of those materializes a pandemic, the seasonal nature of many of those respiratory viruses, you know, argues that there's actually a great benefit in the commercial market as well as for our endemic diseases. So, and that goes to the second part of the question, is that those viruses are things that people are already working on. We just don't have much countermeasures for them because they haven't been a commercial priority. But most of these viruses are BSL-2, biosecurity level 2. They're not, you know, this isn't the Ebola virus type of work that we're talking about here. We're talking about common respiratory viruses. Many labs already do work with those. So I don't think it adds any type of risk, because these are high consequence pathogens in a different sense than the former Soviet Union bioweapons, where you're really worried about lab accidents and people getting infected. This is working with respiratory viruses that are ubiquitous, just not well characterized as pandemic threats, because so much of our pandemic preparedness has been really keyed on to what the former Soviet Union did with their biological weapons program, and then thinking that is synonymous for pandemic preparedness. And that's kind of the paradigm I'm trying to shift and argue against.
I would add in that getting this kind of program up and running is not as heavy a lift as it might sound. Back in, you know, the early 2000s and before, what we had in the United States was a lot of funding going into basic research from NIH. We also had the ability to purchase fully developed product and procure it for the national stockpile in case of a public health emergency. But what we didn't have is any kind of agency in between that early stage funding and the final procurement that would help bring products along through advanced development and manufacture and towards licensure. But in 2006, the Pandemic and All Hazard Preparedness Act actually created, among other things, the Biomedical Advanced Research and Development Authority, called BARDA, within HHS, that is responsible for that advanced development of products. They've been really successful. They have brought, through their investment and their partnerships with companies, a lot of products through to licensure. They work on a list of bioterror agents that, as Amesh said, sort of springs from our Cold War past. They also really focus a lot and productively on influenza. But the rest of the emerging infectious diseases, they don't have money or really a clear remit, a clear mandate to work on other emerging infectious diseases like these kind of viral families. They occasionally get money for that, like during Zika or during Ebola. But for Zika, for instance, they got a surge of supplemental funding. They had to use it up in a year. Then funding dried up and those promising vaccines kind of had nowhere to go that had already been developed. So what we're talking about is giving an already existing successful agency a clear remit and additional funding to focus on these viral families. And it's a perfect combination because NIH is already pivoting to focus on those viral families also, as is CEPI, the international organization with the mandate to produce vaccines for the world, for especially low-resource countries for dangerous pathogens.
So the idea is to match up with the basic science some investments that would lead more quickly to diagnostic tests and therapeutics. So what is the prospect for something like this right now? You know, what is the path to seeing a DiseaseX program launched? Dr. Adalja?
I think there's been broad recognition that the viral family approach is the way that we should be thinking about these problems. However, I think that there's often a lot of emphasis on basic science, forgetting that there's this valley of death, that if we just get products to preclinical development, they may never see the light of day. And the fact that there are senators introducing bills with this whole project in mind, you know, does give me optimism. However, you know, this is politics in Washington, D.C. and other priorities and other ways of other things come up. And it's hard to sometimes articulate that. But I think that if we keep really emphasizing what this pandemic did and how much of it could have been forestalled if we were much more proactive, and the fact that this pandemic touched every person in this country really argues that this should be a priority and that we can get this right. There's a window of opportunity to really put the country on a good footing when it comes to the next pandemic we face. But, you know, obviously everything is subject to kind of the tides in Washington. And I sort of defer to Anita a little bit on the politics part of this.
There are different ways that this new program and funding for it could come into being. One way would be potentially through the Prevent Pandemics Act that Senators Burr and Murray in a bipartisan fashion have introduced, and markup is next week on that bill. And there are some important provisions in that bill already, again, on the NIH side to make sure that NIH is funding research centers that would work in this viral family agnostic approach. But we do need to see a specific, again, remit and funding and sustained funding for BARDA to be able to continue that work. If it doesn't happen through the Prevent Pandemics Act, you know, we're hopeful that in the president's budget that there would be sufficient funding for that. We think the administration has been very forward-looking in terms of needing to prepare for future pandemics, not just limited to coronavirus. So hopefully there'll be items in there that would be applied for advanced research and development of these kind of medical countermeasures. And then, of course, it's back to Congress to make sure that there would be an appropriation for it, probably in the next FY23 cycle.
Great. Well, Anita Cicero, Amesh Adalja, thanks so much for coming to talk with us on Public Health On Call today.
Thank you.
Thanks for having us.
Public Health On Call is produced by Joshua Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Stephanie Desmond. Audio production by Niall Owen McCusker, Matthew Martin, Spencer Greer, and Holly Cardinale, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Production support from Catherine Ricardo. Social media support from Grace Holz Fernandez. Thank you for listening.